Hi, greetings and welcome fellow YouTubers out there. Today we are looking at Kona, Exorcist, VRobot and To The Top. All that coming up on this week's weekly update. Hi, first off, the apologies as usual. Maybe I should stop calling this the intro section of the video and might start calling it the apologies. There we go. Now it's the apologies. Firstly, as I want to say, sorry that I didn't manage to do a weekly update last weekend. It's just that we really was all tight for space, considering there was an awful lot of stuff that was going through last week, but not much on the way of VR, such as, unfortunately, the EU law, Article 11 and Article 13 got passed. They voted yes on, which was a real kick in the pants for us on in Europe. But hopefully, it's not law yet, but we want to try and see if we can stop it before going before it becomes law. So that's the first section. Yes, now this week, another thing that we did last week was Dino Diners, a little thing that I'm trying to see if I can set up. Basically, it was about a dinosaur-themed restaurant where the dinosaurs cut loose and just manically eat each other or fight each other. A little idea that I had from all the other videos that I'm seeing on YouTube. So I'm thinking of having like dinosaur fight arenas. I know it's not virtual reality and it's done with Jurassic Evolved, but maybe I was saying a little bit of a funny comedy spoof or something. Let's see what comes out of it as we go along. Okay, this week, as I said earlier, we've got a couple of games that we went through. So let's go to the first one, which was VRobots. Now, VRobot was awful. I do not recommend this game at all. It was buggy. You had no idea what to do. It just threw you into this open world and didn't even tell you what you need to do. The controls were awful. Not only were they teleportation controls, they were awful style of teleportation controls. There was no actual turn except for turn during teleportation, which was annoying as F. And all that you did when you was inside when you finally managed to figure out how to start a level by finding the little white hand, I'm not talking about the big model hand that was on top of one of the buildings. There was a small icon hand with a zero next to it floating around somewhere in the ether. When you find that and click on it about a couple of thousand times, then you'll go into your first building, and that was how you access the first level of VRobot. Now, I thought VRobot was going to be something like playing with all these different types of toys or interacting with robotic citizens of this robotic era. No, it was none of that. It was just basically destroy everything. Well, destroy everything always seems kind of fun. But this was one of the first games ever in existence that made destroying things seem boring. And I mean be boring with a capital boring. And that is a sin in itself, making destroying buildings and high-rise seem boring. Because all you had to do was, when you went into a level, destroy everything and see if you can destroy as much things within a time limit. And once you're done, next level, next. There were one or two levels that introduced a new feature, like a tornado gun and a long-ass basic robot sword, which in itself seems awesome. A tornado gun, that sounds wicked. And a giant robotic sword that's as big as skyscrapers, wow, that sounds awesome. And this game makes it so boring. So I am really upset with that game. This game is a definite avoid at all costs. It may be a single one-person developer studio, which if they are, I always wish them the best of luck with these games. But this is the sort of thing that makes me think of why did the gaming industry crash right back in the 80s. It's because of these useless type of games that's got no storyline, no gameplay, nothing to it, except for giving money to the people who don't deserve it. Well, yeah, even if it was just a one-person developing studios, please come up with something far more interesting than just a free-for-all smash feast, which was totally boring every single essence. Moving on, the next game we played was Korn. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. K-O-R-N, I think. Or something. As you can see the picture down below. This was an open world mystery game. Now, whereas the first game was totally boring in every sense with no storyline and everything, this seems to be putting up the level a little bit. I wouldn't say it's a survival horror. I wouldn't say it because it's not really survival horror, even though it does have some sort of element that you've got to protect yourself against the cold, otherwise you'll freeze to death. But, I mean, you've got little campfires and enough lighters around the place to keep yourself warm, so it's not too much of a risk. But you're a detective that seems to have ran into this town, and you find everyone vanished, and the first person you meet is dead. This guy was your boss. Spoiler warning, by the way. But that's the whole point of the game, is you kind of got to try and solve these murders, or why everyone's vanishing. Solve the mystery of what's going on around this area. And you get thrown into this supernatural sort of element, spiritual sort of element, whilst you're trekking around. Kind of reminds me, as I said, everyone gone to the rapture. It's odd to call this a walking simulator because it's one of the first walking simulators where you have to start driving to locations. It's a shame that half the stuff that's written down I can't actually read on the VR headset because it is always a little bit too blurry. But the graphics in general are quite good on this, except for the fact that they want to pull it in with a snow blizzard. Snow. Elemental effects like fog and snow. Originally, turn the Wayback Machine all the way back to like the 80s, 90s, or maybe even the beginning of the year 2000. We used environmental effects just to hit to save processing power on the computer. We had the fog around because the computers couldn't really draw the mountains off in the distance or the environment around them. That is no longer the case. We've got consoles and computers that are so powerful enough they can show an entire map right in front of you. Take Skyrim, for instance. If you go to the top of the right peak, you can see miles around with no fog or anything getting in the way, and it is gorgeous. This game main environmental element is the frost of winter. Apart from that minute survival element where you've got to try and keep yourself warm all the time, there is no real point to having this frost of winter. In fact, when you start the game, it's in the middle of summer. middle of summer, you're driving around, then all of a sudden, car crash, then it's middle of winter. And you wonder, where the heck did that sun go? It could, now this is one of my theories, because I haven't actually played this all through, because this seems to be quite a long game, and I've been playing it for a good couple of hours, and I think I've only gotten halfway through. I think that during the car crash, you may have been out cold for, out cold for a very long time and didn't come through till several months later when it's winter. Or maybe even a few years later, which probably explains the absence of everyone. But I don't know. I think there's going to be something about that car crash. Reason why it was summer before the car crash, and when you come to, it was winter afterwards. But apart from that, there is no real point for it to be winter all the time. And I hate the fact that I can't see for more than 2 feet in front of me. I mean, if you find a cabin and go into the cabin, that's great. Yay! I can. Everything is gorgeous. They have beautiful textures, really nicely. They're on the more realistic side of the uncanny valley, on the realistic side, and they do it really good justice. I mean, you can see the blood stains that kind of creep you out. And like I said, I've been enjoying this game whilst I'm playing this. Now, I'm going to be finishing off this game on my Twitch channel later on when I get a few moments to myself to play it. But yeah, I have been quite enjoying this game, and I certainly recommend it if you like open world games, mysteries, and a little bit of crafting. Well, there's no real crafting, but yeah, it's a decent game. I certainly recommend Korn. Next game, To the Top. Now, this game itself, what didn't really appeal to me that much. It appeals to quite a lot of people. There's a lot of fan base out there, much for the whole esports community, where you've got people playing Sprint Vector and such, where you do require a lot of energy to play this. Anyone that's unfit probably might not have a good time playing this, but anyone that wants to try and get fit or keep fit, trying to beat the time trials on this will certainly be a challenge. And if you're up for a challenge, this is great. As I played this because I was called out to play it, to give it a try, to give it a shot. And for an extent, I actually did kind of like it. I mean, it's more of on the stylized side. The graphics themselves are on the stylized side of the Uncanny Valley. There's not much in the way of graphics to it. No real storyline apart from here's an obstacle course, get to the end. And it's a little bit of challenge just to try to get to the end, which in itself was enjoyable. But the real challenge for most people out there will be to get to the end within a certain time limit. And as some of you guys might know, I'm not really a fan for time-limited style games and such, probably because I suck at anything that needs any element of skill to it. But yeah, I mean, this one's a little bit of a 50-50. Great for the challenge, but nothing much else in there. So I gave it approximately about 6 or 7 out of 10, basically on the fact that you just like it for the challenge. And see if you can beat other people in the real world. I know I suck, so therefore I'm not going to get much enjoyment out of it. The last game that we played... what was the last game we played? I think that was the one on Friday, was The Exorcist. Yes, The Exorcist. How can you forget that? That was one mean, scary MF of a game. I myself don't really get scared easily by games. I actually quite enjoy a good old game that really tries to scare you. And this didn't really scare me all that much. I mean, if you don't believe me, check out the game footage itself. I had like this, I opened a door and there was, you had the jump scare sound effect with the corpse inside it and the pig tag inside it. And I said, oh, You don't really look very good. I wonder what happened to you. I itch. Sorry. And also, it looks like they've got a couple of weeping angels that was in the first level. The majority of the thing that I was concerned about was not having the right tool in the hand at the time. That was a problem for me. So you couldn't move and have the book open. Well, while I'm in the book, we had this sort of little container. On the first level, you went around, basically you picked up all these sort of paraphernalia, such as the container, the lighter, the cross, the holy water, and the salt cellar. Now, with the lighter, you basically use it to sort of shine yourself around. You've got cross to exorcise certain spirits. I have no idea what the salt shaker was, Diane. It seemed practically useless for the game itself. And the holy water seemed to help put out some fires. In each of the episodes, this was an episodic game. The game so far has got 3 episodes available, with 2 more to come. And we played through all 3 episodes. As I said, the first episode was mainly there just to get you all the paraphernalia that you need. Like I said, one of the problems that I had with the paraphernalia is the container. When you open it, you can only pick out one item to use in your other hand. You cannot move whilst the container is open, which was a shame, because there was a lot of time where I wanted to hold the container open whilst holding the cross around, and then I should quickly change it for the salt shaker just in case I needed it, or change it for the salt. But no, I couldn't do that. If I wanted to change it for anything else, I needed to stand still and keep it and to open it up. So I need to close the book and close down the inventory if I needed to walk around or move forward or anything, which is a shame. As I said, the first level got you all the stuff. The second level was a little bit claustrophobic, if you don't like that sort of thing. I don't mind it myself. It didn't seem to have too much in there, apart from you going around these very tight spaces whilst the spooky voices start talking to you, and flames kept erupting out of the floor. The third one was very much a story-driven focus, story-central-driven focus, where basically you're there to look after a child, and the child gets kidnapped by demons, and then you go and look into the history of the parents, and you find out all sorts of creepy stuff about the history of the house and such. But there's a lot of times in there when I don't know if I was over waiting for something to happen, or I needed to do something to make it happen. It was a shame that a lot of the areas are dark. Now, I know that in scary games, they make things dark to try to induce suspense. But they don't really need to do that. They've already induced enough suspense in the game already. I want to see what's going on around here. Maybe have some sort of grey-style dark where I can actually see the items around me, not just pitch-back screen. So I have to constantly try and get the lighter out and keep clicking the lighter just to relight it every second. Because I know some people find that's basically scary when you go down to a dark area, the lighter goes out and you have to keep on relighting it just so you can see what's in front of you. I know some people find that a bit scary. I find it plain annoying having to keep on trying to get the light just so I can see what's around me. But as I say, going forward, that was quite cool and had quite a nice little combat finale at the end that you had to deal with. Out of all the tools, the only one that I found that I really needed to use was the cross. And that was, as I said, to exorcise spirits out of objects and things. I had to use the holy water once or twice, as I said, to get rid of the fires on some of the levels. But apart from that, I didn't really need to use much else. Oh yeah, and the lighter just to look around. As I said, that just leaves the salt shaker, and we I have no idea what the salt shaker does. One last thing I want to note is that on each of the levels, there was a certain puzzle element that you had to figure out. I think if you figured out the puzzle element, you get some sort of bonus factor or bonus thing that, I don't know, gave you points or a bragging rights status or something. You didn't need to figure out the puzzles into process in the game, but figuring out the puzzles would have been bonus. And when it comes to puzzle elements, I think that's kind of a good idea, just to have them as a bonus rather than a necessity. Because lots of times when you go to an area, you're faced with this particular puzzle and you cannot continue until you solve the puzzle, and people like stand there around scratching their heads for ages, then they'll either A, give up and go away and never play the game again, or go onto YouTube and see if they can find someone else who's done the puzzle, and therefore basically overriding the actual need why it's there in the first place. The fact that they've got these as an optional extras, I think is a good idea, good advantage. So that, because some people do like puzzles, they do like to try and solve them, they do like to try and figure it out. And the fact that you don't have to do it to proceed makes everyone else happy, so you can continue. So I thought that was cool. That was a good game. Overall, good storyline. Good little bit of gameplay. I believe that it was I can say this was quite definitely a walking simulator style game, because I don't think there was any real risk in there. I don't think at any point in the game I could have died. I don't know about the ending though, on the third chapter with the snakes and the baby. I don't know what would happen if the snakes got the baby, because I didn't let them. But like I said, in general, I don't think you could have died in this game, which is one of the reasons why you don't really get scared. If there's no risk, there's no scare. But I'm sure a lot of people always find that these sort of games quite creepy, with the jump scares and the weeping angels and the... Okay, well, sorry I'm going to keep this quick, because... A, time is kind of getting on for me at the moment, and B, I just realised my camera's running out. So I'll wrap this up for now. I don't think there is much else that I want to go through with you. Last thing that I wanted to talk about was the 5-minute movie night that I put on yesterday. Originally, we was going to do the... If You Know, Tell, which was kind of gruesome at the end of this. Well, not at the end, for the majority of it. It's a little bit freakish and not really sort of the same style of my channel that I'd like to portray. So for the moment, I've just put it out. I've changed it for next week's, which is... Let's Trade, which I think is a much nicer, much more friendly and much more funny advert, five minute video. But I have put on the If You Know, Tell for next week. So if you want to see all gruesome stuff, have a look at that. It's not really gruesome, it's just freaky or weird, however you pronounce it. But for now, I'll just quickly wrap up. Thanks very much for watching. I hope you've enjoyed watching this as much as I've enjoyed creating this. Please don't forget to like and subscribe. There are plenty of other things that we're doing all the time, whether it be PSVR. I'm also going to be working on the next Stickmen in Space project soon. Just a short little mini project I'm going to be looking at. Maybe some 360 videos coming up soon as well. So please keep in touch. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and I'll see you guys out there.